Here's what I want you to do. I want you to take a huge breath in your belly. Big breath. Hold it. Now get tight. How's that working for you? It's like putting a bounce house into a little duffel bag, isn't it? It's never gonna work. Okay, so what we need to do is create a little tiny space. The way your body works is that your pelvis and your butt set your pelvic position, or excuse me, your butt sets your pelvic position. And then once I've organized the pelvis, which is sort of the seat of your power, then I can start to make changes and organize around that. If I'm over tilted, go ahead and overextend for me, because you know what I'm talking about there in your little Lululemon pants, all overextended, okay? So now in this position, make your abs tight. How's that going for you? Yeah, and what happens is that your body obeys basic principles, that if you're disorganized or in a bad position, things don't turn on. If you're in a good position, things turn on. Does that make sense? You following me? So, first things first, get your feet underneath your lungs. Now look at this. If you're standing like a duck, how do you then do you're gonna walk? Like a duck, and we'll get into that, why that's a problem in a second. So feet need to be straight underneath your lungs, pointed straight ahead when you stand. Does that make sense? So squeeze your butt as hard as you can. And look what happened. Everyone's pelvis went into this nice neutral position. Now it's set like a Ronco. You set it and forget it. Now take a big breath in your belly. Exhale and get tight. Now you're stiff, right? Now you have already set your spinal position and you're good to go. And if you need to breathe or move, we can do that. But these are complex concepts. Relax, everyone. And what happened? Well, you went right back into hanging on the meat. We teach this to our five-year-olds at our gym. It's very complex, isn't it? All this motor control, and this is how we do it. You hit 1 5-year-old one time, and they all understand. Look, you need to always have your abs on a little bit. See, he's already braced. And here's the concept. If I see you with the rest of this CrossFit Games, and I walk up to you, I might just whack you in the, oh, she's good to go. See how that works? Do not, I'm a professional, do not be unprofessional. Check it, okay? So look. The reason I'm saying that is go ahead and put your arms over your head like you're swinging a kettlebell. Oh, by the way, you can't support heavy loads over your head with your arms bent. So arms straight. I need to see your ears. Arms need to be straight, sir. If you don't straighten your arms, someone's going to die. Straighten your arms. Okay, arms straight. Now, how many of you guys squeezed your butt before you went up? No discipline. That's the point. Now, go ahead and do that again. Arms up. Don't worry about your butt. Now, you didn't get in a good position. Come down. This time squeeze your butt. Belly tight. Now go up. Now you're organized. Now watch this. This is going to be disgusting as a big group. Ready? Turn your butt off on three. One, two, three. Turn your butt off. Oh, 100% of us overextended. So what happens when that million-pound kettlebell comes crashing down now? I'm in the worst turdy position ever. Does that make sense? In order to control the spine, I have to think about what's happening at the pelvis. Does that make sense to you guys? You're tracking me. So if I have to control my shoulder rib cage relationship, that's got to start at the pelvis. Are you following me? Okay, don't mess this up for the rest of the day. So now, we have a quick template. I squeeze my butt, belly tight. We put out videos that make this a little bit more sophisticated. So if you're standing on one leg, what does it tell me you're doing? You're trying to get out of extension because this is killing your back, isn't it? Have you guys ever, I don't know if this is true because you're all paleo, have you ever gone drinking at a bar before? It's possible. There are these things called bars. And at the bottom of the bar, there's a bar. Have you seen that before? What's that for? And what happens when you're to your pelvis when you put your feet up? Oh, you're back in that neutral position, and then your back doesn't hurt, and you can drink longer. Yeah, hey, it's functional. That's right. So that's what I'm trying to do. I want to show you that a lot of times we see people working really hard about trying to get out of this bad spinal position. And you'll be like, I don't do that. And what you've done is you've created the three spines. This is the athlete with the three spines. I have one spine, two spines, three spines. Does that make sense? So we need to create a second relationship. Because right now I've set my pelvis in neutral, belly is down, I'm organized, rib cage is down, so we teach it our level one. But in this schema, I'm just balancing over the heads of my femurs, and that doesn't make sense, does it? I have this rigid column, and I'm just kind of swaying back and forth. So under this paradigm, how the heck am I going to stabilize? Well, I have two options. I can either do this, or all of you guys, we do this. And that's how that open circuit fault happens. So what's the mechanism then to create a stable trunk? I got it. Squeeze my butt, belly tight. Good. But now there's a reciprocating feature off of the limb, off of the primary engine. And that when I create torque, when I try to, and torque is break the barbell, armpit forward, knees out, gymnastics turnout on the rings, elbows in. All of the language that we use as our primary coaching vehicles are languages of rotation, languages of creating stability and torque in the system. Your femur and humerus work like a ball and socket, so that if that ball and socket is in a bag of connective tissue, if I organize and round up, it becomes stable like a candy. Otherwise, I'm just pulling on it. Does that make sense? So what's cool about the human being over 2.5 million years is that you've evolved to create stability through this rotational concept and rotation. I can give you 50 examples of why this works, but just trust me on this for now, right? Because Bergner tells me to get my armpit forward, and I know what that means. Does that make sense? That's that rotation. Have you guys seen the movie Avatar? It's pretty awesome, right? No, it wasn't. And here's why. Do you see them draw the bow? Yeah, the blue or enlightened people draw the bow. They're all internally rotated. Right? That's a weak position. No enlightened. I was like, jump the shark. That makes no sense mechanically. The shoulder impingement position? I don't think so. They'd be externally rotated. And that external rotation. So let's give you a plan now so they don't have to stand like this. Do you see? What is that? Imagine you come up to, like, you ask a, you know, you're like, hey, I want to take your daughter out for a romantic dinner. And you're like, I don't trust you. So here it is. Feet straight forward for me. Squeeze your butt. Belly tight. Now you're organized. And you see how you were disorganized for a second, weren't you? 20% organization all the time. Now, I want you to screw your feet into the ground as hard as you can. Create as much torque into the ground as hard as you can. Like your feet are on dinner plates, screw them into the ground. You got to get tight, screw them into the ground. That's where we're going to measure that torque. Squeeze your butt as hard as you can. Feel as tight as you can get it. Screw your feet in the ground as hard as you can. Okay. Now, turn your feet out 30 degrees for me. It's not very much, is it? Many of you squat in this position, huh? Curious. Okay. Now, squeeze your butt as hard as you can. Is it more or less? Screw your feet in the ground as hard as you can. What's happening? Womp womp. That's right. That's a loveless home. That's a low torque environment. Go 45 degrees, because I know some of you guys overhead squat there, don't you? Go ahead and create some torque. Is there any torque to be had? That's a torque vacuum, isn't it? So the second part of this, or the next part of this equation, this reciprocation, is that I have to put myself into a position where I can create torque, because that stabilizes the primary engines of the hip and shoulder, but it also makes the trunk stable. And what we see is that athletes who are standing, who don't have their feet straight forward, aren't capable of creating torque, and that means it's really difficult for me to stabilize the trunk and pelvis, and so what ends up happening is we start to see dysfunctional positions.